My name is Naimeh Shakur. I'm also known by my birth name, Sheila Nortley. I'm a former model and currently work as a producer for film and television. I embraced Islam in 2008.
Oh, here we go. I was brought up in Mitcham, born and bred in Mitcham, which is just on the borderline of London and Surrey. It's quite a nice, well, it's got its good parts and it's got its bad parts. The part that I'm from is actually technically more modern. Growing up, it was actually quite a racist area. Loads of NFs, which are National Front people, so, you know, kind of like, they didn't really like black people. But I went to school in Tooting, which was a lot more multicultural. In primary school, there weren't that many Muslim children at all, not that I can remember. Or, to be honest, growing up, I had a lack of understanding about Islam. So I always thought Islam was a religion for Asians and Arabs. So at school, a lot of the children may have been Muslim, but I just would have thought, you know, the Asian kids are of Hinduism or Islam and not really known the difference. But growing up, secondary school, there were one or two Muslims. And I remember when I was in sixth form, I was about 16, 17, and there was a girl, a Muslim girl, and she didn't cover her hair. And I remember saying to her, "Are you Muslim?" She said, "Yeah." I said, why don't you wear hijab?" I said, do you believe that God wrote the Quran?" She said, "Yeah." And he said, "You should wear hijab." She said, "Yeah." I said, "So why don't you wear it?" And now looking back, I realise what a forward question that it was for me to have asked her. But yeah, that was my first kind of experience speaking to a Muslim about Islam. And there was also a boy in my class called Abdul Hakim, a Somalian boy. And he used to talk to me a little bit. And he said to me, "You know what, you'd make a lovely Muslim." That's what he said to me. And I was obviously a Christian at the time. And he meant, because I was very shy at school, I was very, I'd like to think I had, you know, good manners, probably better manners than I grew up to have. But when he said that to me, I remember thinking, you know, what does that mean? And looking back, I realised what a lovely compliment that was, mashallah. My family are very religious, especially on my mum's side. They're Christian. Yeah, my mum's family is very, very Christian. My dad's family is also very, very Christian. My mum actually did a Christian theology course recently. So she's something now that's called a lay reader, which means she goes to church, she wears the white gown, and she preaches in the church. As a young teen, I was very interested in African history, being that I'm obviously from Africa originally. So, you know, I had an idea that there is an answer to all of these questions, but I had so many more questions than answers. And I knew, you know, hear information about this and information about that. But it wasn't knowledge, because it was just scattered bits of information and I couldn't put it all together. Whereas now that I'm Muslim, it's like everything, I can see the whole picture now. I can see where this relates to that and where that relates to that. And I find, to me, Islam to be the only religion that doesn't exclude the world, whereas a lot of religions, it's like, okay, it's just you and God, you go to church once a week, or, you know, and it's very individualistic. Whereas Islam, it encourages you to look at history, look at what's happening in other countries, be aware of current affairs, because every single thing is linked. So Islam has provided me with a lot of the answers to many of the questions I have. I'm never going to know anything. And Islam has also provided me with that peace of mind that you may never know everything. You know, you may have all these conspiracy theories in your head, and you know, you're trying to work out, well, why did that happen? What does that symbol mean? You know, blah, blah, blah. But the truth is, you might never know, but have peace in that you know who your Lord is, you know who you are, and you know from the prophecies of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and what he said would happen, that's what's going to come to pass. So you kind of have peace. Yeah, I have a lot of peace now.
As a child growing up in the church, I would go every Sunday to church with my family, and I used to quite enjoy it. My mum's church was a Church of England church, so it was quite, it wasn't quite, you know, there's a lot of churches which are quite charismatic and they clap and they sing. This church was very formal. I remember getting in trouble for talking and things like this in church. But it wasn't somewhere I particularly wanted to go. I remember when it got to the point when I was doing my my confirmation, there's a process that you go through. When you're about 14 and you're old enough to make your own decisions, they do what's called a confirmation in the church to kind of confirm you into Christianity now that you're a young man or a young woman. And it was at that point that the trouble really started, because I started asking a lot of questions. You know, I was a very inquisitive child and I was not stupid. I think I was quite an intelligent young lady, so mashallah. So I would ask questions, and I'd go and I'd ask my questions, and they started to have a problem with that, and they'd be like, oh, she's putting up her hand again. And it got to a point, it got so bad that they said I shouldn't be confirmed. They said, you're obviously not ready. And that's when I thought, how can I have faith in something or believe in something and they don't want me to ask any questions? And my questions were sincere, they weren't to cause trouble, but I wanted to know, you know, why there were so many discrepancies in the Bible. And I think my questions were also making other people say, yeah, why is that? You know, why is this? And they didn't have the answers. And rather than say, we'll find out the answers, they said, you're not ready. And I thought, yeah, maybe I'm not. And it was at that point that I just kind of realised, yeah, there were a few question marks for me about in the religion of Christianity. And I've always been someone who's searching. And that's what I was doing. I was kind of, I was online and I was trying to make Christianity make sense for me, because I believed there was a God. I believed, you know, reading the Bible, I believed a lot of it. I believed in the prophets. I believed that God wouldn't leave us on this earth without giving us a guidance. But I couldn't understand why there were so many mistakes, so many discrepancies. I knew that it had been changed. I knew why it had been changed. So I kind of felt, I believe in a God who would allow me to use my intellect to reason and rationalize. And so basically at the point when I embraced Islam, I was trying to find a way to make Christianity work for me. I had a friend, a Muslim friend, who I couldn't, he basically just recently got married. So I wasn't able to speak to him much, but in a brief time I spoke to him, he said to me, Islam is the truth. And I remember saying to him, you know, are you sure? Like, are you 100% sure? Because I will look into it. And he said, trust me, this is the truth. And then he just disappeared. So I'd research online and I'd write down all my questions. And there was an Islamic shop in Tooting. And I'd go there with a page of questions. And I'd ask, there's a brother in the shop, and I'd ask him all my questions, one by one by one, and he'd answer them. I said, okay, thank you. And then I'd go home, and then I'd make up another long list of questions, and I'd do the same thing. And I remember the second or third time I went back, I went there and I said, Assalamu alaikum. And I remember he said, oh, you're coming far, and like that, and I felt really embarrassed. But the last time when I went to him, I went with my questions, and he answered all of them. And I, you know, I'd done my research, and I'd say, okay, you know, why do the women have to pray behind the men, and why do the women have to cover up, and why this, why that, and how do you know the Quran hasn't been changed? And I said to him, look, if this is the truth, I'm gonna do it, and I'm gonna put my heart and soul into this. So I need to get these questions answered. So I went through all my questions with him, and then he said to me, have you got any more questions? And that's the point that I realized. You know, I said, no. It was just silence, and it was like, okay, now what, you know? And I said, okay, well, I'm going to go now. And he's like, well, if you have no more questions, you have no more questions. And it was at that point that I realized that if I leave this shop, I thought in my heart, if I leave this shop and I know now that this is the truth, if I leave this shop and I haven't embraced this religion and anything happens to me, I'm going to be accountable for not making a decision that I know to be the truth. So I said, you know, I said, I want to become a Muslim. And he was so surprised. He said, what, now, here, now? I said, yeah. So he got, there were some other brothers, and he called them in to be witnesses. And then they repeated the Shahada completely. I'd never heard these words before in my life, but I said them and he translated it for me, and I believed 100% at that point that this is the truth. So that's how I became a Muslim. Alhamdulillah.
Okay, cool. Okay, so who are you auditioning for today? Okay, cool. So we're just going to run through the script. Is anyone going to read anything?
So what I basically do is I'm responsible for the whole production of a film. So it's everything from script development, casting, getting directors on board, getting crew on board, hair, makeup, getting everybody on board to make this particular production.
Open the door.
How it relates to my Islamic journey is I've always been a storyteller. I've always been someone that has liked to communicate through writing as opposed to speaking, as I'm doing now, or as opposed to standing in front of people and addressing people. I've always used the pen to communicate. And I found that with film, no matter who you are, where you're from, or what you believe in, film is a very powerful way to communicate a message to people. So me being a Muslim, I find it a tool that I can use to share what I think, what I feel, and also to provide a platform for those who have maybe more knowledge or insight than me to express what they believe. And I think that it's evident in my work where my iman is and where my relationship to Allah is. You can see when I was more conscious of what I was putting out there. And when I was less conscious of what I was putting out there, and that's very evident in my work. So there are certain topics that I do not want to promote. There are certain issues that I do not want to promote. And there are also certain issues that I want to highlight. And I want to do that as myself. And as myself, I'm a Muslim. So that is the perspective that a lot of it will be coming from.
I'm Daniel Bailey, I'm an actor. I met Naimeh in 2005. I starred in her first film, which was The Hydra, in 2008. It won an award at the Black Filmmakers Award in 2009. When I first met Naimeh, she wasn't Muslim at the time. She was, I would say, more leaning towards Christian faith at that moment in time. It was a bit of a shock because, as I said, she had very strong Christian friends, very, very strong, and the reactions from some of her friends were they were a bit thrown off. They didn't understand why she had converted, or what pushed her to convert, or what she had found, why she chose to convert. So they wasn't as accepting at that time. Being a Muslim isn't the easiest thing in the Western world at this time, especially getting into media, getting into that industry is very difficult. For you to be a woman is difficult, for you to be a black woman is difficult, for you to be a woman that's black, that's also Muslim, you can imagine it's very, very difficult. But I don't think she hasn't allowed that to be a stumbling block. She hasn't allowed that to halt her in any way or hinder her careers or aspirations. She hasn't allowed that to become a barrier, and that's why I love her for that, because honestly it's an ongoing battle. Just coming into a room with a hijab amongst executives can be intimidating for them, I think, not for her, but for them. For me personally, I was always going to stick by Naimeh, and I was happy that she converted, because once she had converted, I could see that she got more focused. She definitely started pursuing her dreams much more, and she became more of a woman.
To be honest, my journey in Islam has been very interesting, because when I first reverted in 2008, I did what a lot of people do. I was like, this was like a big secret that I felt everyone had hidden. It was like, this is like a gem of truth that just stands out in a world that is filled with lies and deception. So I just thought, oh my, you know, this is wonderful. This is what I've always been looking for. So I cut off myself from a lot of people, and I just jumped in head first. And for someone with very, very little knowledge, to be honest, you know, I haven't studied intensely. It can be quite overwhelming, and it can be quite excessive. So then I completely stepped away for a while.
Now I'm at a place where I'm kind of trying to find the balance and have a balance in all areas of my life with an Islamic core behind it. When you first become Muslim, there's a fear of being judged by your non-Muslim friends. And when you become Muslim, there's still a fear of being judged by your Muslim friends, and you can never ever please everybody. So a lot of people have actually surprised me and said, no, you know, I think it's good what you're doing. Just try and keep sincere and try and keep your intention pure. And I just try and do what I believe to be right. And I've not received too much criticism, though there may be people that may say things not to me, but, you know, that's between them and Allah, really, not me. My family were much more understanding than I imagined. I was really scared to tell them I was Muslim. Yeah, I remember I told my mum in the kitchen, she was cooking, and it was just a burden because me and my mum were so close. We're so close, and I love my mum so much, and I was so scared to upset her. So I was in the kitchen, and I just said, "Mum, I want to tell you something." She's like, "What?" I said, "I'm Muslim." And I think she probably, I can't remember exactly what her first response was, but she was just very, I was expecting the worst, yeah, and she just kind of nodded, and she was like, okay. I think she didn't really know what to expect, and that was it, and I kind of wanted more from her, but she didn't give too much away. Then it was telling my dad that was the big deal, where I said, "Mum, how am I going to tell dad? And that dragged on, and I think he went to Ghana and came back, and I still hadn't told him. And I was like, mom, how am I going to tell dad? And she said it for me. She just said, "Ernest, your daughter's saying she's Muslim." And I was very surprised by his response. He said, okay. And to be honest, it's my dad that has been very, I think it's brought me and my dad closer, strangely enough, because when my family, my extended family, well, you know, my auntie, she's very Christian, and she said, "The devil's got you," and blah, blah, blah. And she phoned him, my dad's sister, to speak to him. And she said, "Oh, I want to speak to Naimeh." She came on the phone and she said, "You know, what are you doing? You know, the devil has obviously got you. You've been misled." And my dad took the phone away from it, and he just really defended me. And I was so surprised and so happy. And he said to her, what she believes and what we believe is the same. We believe in one God. But then we worship him through Jesus. She worships him through Muhammad. So I let him finish. And then I said, "Actually, Dad, we don't actually worship through Muhammad. Listen, we just believe we can worship God directly." And he's like, "Really?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Okay." And he'd listen to me. You know, and one time I remember he said to me as well, he said, "If what you're doing is correct, then you have to teach us." He said, because we don't know. And he said, all of our grandma, our great-grandma, like your ancestors, as far back as he knows, have all been Christian. And he said, "You're doing something different. And if what you're doing is the truth, you need to tell us about it." And he always would give me these, and he still does, give me these opportunities to speak with him. And I remember when I had the chicken pox, I had chicken pox a few months ago, April. And it was horrible. And again, my dad, when I was better, he knocked on my door. He said, "You're better." And I said, "Yeah." He said, "It's Allah that healed you." And he said, "Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar." And I took my phone out and I started recording, because I said, "I can't believe it." You know what I mean? And I just, he really does make an effort. When anything goes right for me, he makes an effort, and my mum as well. So I can't complain. You know, the meat in the house is usually, they buy halal. If it's not halal, they'll tell me. You know, and we can now just have a joke and a laugh. Like one time my mum cooked and it smelled so nice. I was like, "Oh mum, I can't wait." And she said, "Oh, it's pork." And I said, "Oh mum, you're persecuting me." I said, "Why are you persecuting the Muslims?" And we just have a joke like that, because obviously I can't eat it. So now things are okay. But me and my mum, there has been a bit of a distance between us, which has been quite hard for me. Yeah, but we're getting there. Alhamdulillah, we're getting there.
Okay, mom.
Hello. Yeah. How have you been?
I went to Aisha's for a little bit. We were casting for my new film and all that kind of stuff. Busy.
I know. Same here.
Mum, everyone wants to know, how did you feel when I told you I was Muslim or I was becoming Muslim?
It was very difficult for me, really. Because I remember when you came home from uni and then you started putting scarves on when you were going out, and I thought, what's happening? You know, in the summer and you got scarves.
I'll play around my neck. Yes. When I go out, then I'll
you know, and you know, I started suspecting, but I mean, I couldn't ask because probably I was scared of the answer I would get. But then eventually, you told me, and I thought, you know, that really took me back a bit.
Has it got easier?
I think so, even though it's still difficult. But, you know, as you know, I did this interfaith thing on my course. Mm-hmm. So probably it's opened my eyes a bit to it. But it's still very difficult for me because thinking that I've taken you to church and, you know, I want you to get involved in all these churchy things in my church where I am now as a lay reader, it's difficult for me.
Hardest part? Is it the way I dress or is it when I say I'm going to go pray or what do you find?
Oh, I don't mind about prayers at all because I'm all for prayers.
So what do you find?
But I think, well, to be honest, I mean, I've been saying this all the time that because of these terrorist things, you know, I just get scared for you.
Yeah.
Dressed like that because everybody will know, oh, Muslims, you know, and you know, there's like they've painted Muslims as being.
But what about you? Do you think that Muslims are terrorists? Is that what you think? I'm not gonna go into
I know, but
how do you feel when other people in the family like are quite kind of a bit harsh, like, you know, why am I becoming Muslim? Why am I dressing this way? How do you cope with it?
Well, the only thing I say is that I've been always praying to God to guide you and guide me. If I'm going the wrong way, rather, he will guide me where to go. So, I can't really judge you in that way that, you know, you are doing something wrong.
You're beautiful.
You know what I mean?
You're beautiful. Because I do the same thing.
Yeah.
Like I pray for God to guide me and for God to guide you and for God to guide the family.
Yes.
And in the five prayers that we do, we say, Ihdina Sirata Mustaqim, which means guide us on the straight path, the path of those who, goes and say the path of those who you have chosen. And I think whether you're Christian or Muslim, whatever you are, you want to be guided to the straight path.
Exactly,
so My prayer for you is the same.
Yeah, so it's, you know, same both ways, really. You know, we just take each day at a time. You keep praying, I keep praying, and then, you know, we'll see what the Almighty will do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Inshallah. I believe in, inshallah.
A proper cuddle, don't be shy. She's so small that I actually just have to hold her. But yeah, I love you so much, mama. Thank you for it. Like, I really, really do appreciate it.